All right. Good morning, everyone. It looks like people joining us slowed down a little bit. My name is Adam Prescott. I'm an attorney at Bernstein, Shur in Portland, Maine. And thank you for joining us today. Before I get started, I want to turn it over to Claudio Ruiz, who's going to introduce the Spanish translation services we have today.
Thank you, Adam. Very glad to be here. In order to enable interpretation, you will see a globe icon at the bottom of the Zoom screen. You will click on that and choose the English of your, the channel of your preference. In this case, English. You will be able to hear anything that someone might happen to be speaking in Spanish. I will be translating that. I will now give the same instructions in Spanish. Muy buenos días. Gracias por estar aquí. Vamos a comenzar el proceso de interpretación en un segundo. Usted va a ver un icono de un globo en la parte de abajo de la pantalla de Zoom. Usted le va a hacer clic ahí y escoger el canal de español para poder escuchar la interpretación que voy a estar haciendo yo. Gracias.
Great. Great. Thank you, Claudia. And thanks again to everyone for joining us for our cooperative webinar series. Today is the third of five webinars. If you were unable to attend the first two over the prior 2 weeks, the recordings are available. And if you don't have access to them, feel free to reach out and we can point them to you. I also hope you're able to join us for the last two webinars in the upcoming 2 weeks. Today, we are going to be talking about cooperatives and maintaining financial health for your cooperatives. As I mentioned, my name is Adam Prescott. I'm a lawyer in the Business and Restructuring Practice Group at Bernstein Shur in Portland, Maine. And I'm joined today on the panel by Chris Linder. If we're going to go to the next slide, Rebecca. Joined by Chris Linder. Chris is the Loan and Outreach Officer at Cooperative Fund of the Northeast. And then also joined today by John Crane, who's the General Manager of the Portland Food Co-op, also right here in Portland, Maine. Skip ahead to the agenda. We have a lot to cover today. Questions, feel free to use the chat feature. We'll try and address any questions as we go. If we can't get to them during the presentation, we have some time at the end and we'll try to get to them then. And obviously if there's anything we don't cover or any follow-up at the end, we'll provide our contact information. Don't hesitate to reach out to everyone. In terms of today's agenda on the next slide, we are gonna start off just with some brief introduction to the concept of the cooperative as a business, which may not be a novel concept, but it's important for some of the issues we're gonna discuss today. Then we're gonna take a look at financial documents. People come to the webinar with a variety of different backgrounds in financial literacy. And so we're gonna walk through some of that. We're gonna talk a little bit about signs of financial distress. And then we're gonna talk about how to actually present and use financial information, including some demonstrations from actual slides and charts that John uses at the Portland Food Co-op. And finally, we'll conclude with some questions and answers, as I mentioned. To get started, again, cooperatives at their core are, of course, businesses. And I know John, Chris rather, when we were sort of preparing for this, I think it was you who mentioned the phrase, no margin, no mission, which I think is a great way to sort of cover a lot of what we want to address today, right? And the basic premise is that without a sound financial business, the cooperative cannot achieve its other goals, right? And so again, that may sound obvious to some or many people, but we think it's something that's worth pausing on, right? Because that financial business and financial model is what everything else that the co-op hopes to achieve is based off of, right? So let me maybe turn it over to you, Chris, in terms of the no margin, no mission concept. What does that mean to you, and how do you see that interplay with the cooperatives you deal with?
With cooperatives, I mentioned this in the other webinar that we had last week. I often call cooperatives the original benefit corporations, the B Corps. We as cooperatives are inherently mission-based. Just like Adam said, it's important to meet that mission. But if we're not making money, we can't pay payroll, we can't pay vendors, then we can't exist tomorrow. So we might be fine today, but tomorrow or next year, we won't be in great shape. And just like any business, we do see cooperatives winding down and closing. So that's no different than other businesses. And it's, you know, just like anything, you all have probably heard, what matters is what you measure. So you have to take a very close look at the key success factors in your business, and that includes the financial piece of what you do as well, and should be balanced with the mission, because it's not all about let's maximize profit, but it is about we got to pay our bills and maybe save a little bit for a rainy day in reserve for things that we're not sure, you know, COVID, for example. That is your rainy day example right there. So, yeah.
No, thanks, Chris. Yeah, certainly there's a wide spectrum of what it means to be, you know, financially successful and financially stable. And it's going to vary based on, you know, the cooperative and the industry and the location. And, you know, Chris, we've also had the opportunity to work together on a cooperative bankruptcy case, right? So cooperatives are not immune from the economic pressures that any other business goes from, right? And certainly, you know, one thing we've talked about in the prior webinars about startup cooperatives and cooperative conversions is, you know, the members as owners, right? And as a result of that, the members have, especially in a worker co-op, the workers have an opportunity to share in the profits of the business, right? And so, you know, there's a direct incentive, not only for your sort of cooperative principles, but also financially to have a sound business, right? And we're going to talk a little bit about today about how you know that you have a sound business, what you should be looking for, and some sort of basic financial information. So why don't we go on to the next slide, and we'll jump right into more of the substance here. One thing we wanted to talk about before we even get into things like, you know, balance sheets and profit and loss statements and some of that is the importance of budgeting. I know in my world, where I work with a lot of companies who financial distress, one of the very first things we do when we get involved is work with those companies on preparing budgets, whether it's prepare new ones or update other ones, right? Because you can't run the business, or you're gonna have a difficult time running the business if you do not know where your cash is coming from, where it's going, and when that's occurring, right? And there's a lot of different ways to prepare a budget. They can look a lot of different ways, they can reflect a lot of different things, but there's significant value in the exercise and in the work product, both in the future performance of your business and then comparing how you're actually doing compared to your goals, right? So why don't we maybe turn it over to you, John, to talk a little bit about, from the Portland Co-op perspective, how you handle budgeting and what role it plays in your business operations.
Great, thank you, Adam. Yeah, I cannot stress enough how important accurate budgeting is in any business operation. I don't care if you are a farm or a retail store or insurance agency or a housing cooperative or what you are doing. There's such a misconception when people get into business, I think in general, or cooperative business, that increasing revenue means success. And it is very easy to increase your money coming in and at the same time having a greater increase in money going out and actually losing money in the process. And you're not going to notice this is happening until you take a hard look at your checking account over time. And so maintaining a healthy business, it is so important right in the startup process. I mean, do not go into any business venture without at least 3 years of pro forma financial statements, really 5 years being the most optimum. That's what we did when we started the Portland Food Co-op. Partially because we knew we were going to lose money in the beginning. You know, a lot of businesses do, but we also knew where the break-even point is and at what point we should begin making money. And the important reason to do that is to know that you have the accumulated cash at the startup to see you through. And so many co-ops don't realize they don't have a viable model until they start running low on cash. And you should know that you're running low on cash way before you ever reach any type of emergency stage where you're doing things like deferring paying of bills or struggling to meet payroll or doing things like that. But for so many co-ops, I've seen this, that they get to that point before they really realize that they don't have a profitable business model. And so I always have a five-year budget, and I update it every year and move it forward. Excel is your best friend for something like this. So there are lots of different models out there, free on the internet. You do not need to recreate the wheel on this, but know all of your expenses, right down to how much you are spending on envelopes and stamps and paper towels for the bathroom. Really have a really solid idea of how much money per day it costs you to keep your co-op going. And then you can always look at what is your cash on hand and know what a number that everyone needs to know is days of cash on hand, so that you know you are always prepared for the ups and downs that can happen in a business cycle. And if I was explaining this 3 or 4 years ago, people would wonder, well, what kind of things are you talking about? To say, theoretically, a global pandemic came along and shut your business down for 2 weeks or 6 weeks or 6 months. Would you be able to weather something like that? And I think the pandemic has made this much more real to most of us now, that you have to have adequate cash on hand, or at least access to cash through a line of credit with a lender to see you through those times. But you really need to know exactly how much money you should be spending every day on all of the different expenses that you have, and then monitoring that on a weekly, monthly, quarterly basis. Are you keeping to budget, so that you know if you intend on being profitable at the end of the year or the end of the second year, that you are on track to get there and you can make adjustments along the way?
John, let me ask at the Portland Food Co-op, who's involved for your business in preparing the projections, and sort of what time of year do you do that? Are you sort of preparing them over the summer for the next year? Do you wait till later in the year? What's the process like?
Okay. Well, in terms of who's responsible, that is 95% me. I am the finance manager as well as the general manager. Larger cooperatives do actually have someone in that CFO or finance manager role who does that. But I would say we operate on a calendar year, and budgeting for me starts in January as I'm learning how my previous year's budget is not matching up with reality. And so I'm always watching that. Inflation happens. That's been a really key part this year. We've all seen our utility costs go up. A lot of costs of doing business are going up. I'm tracking those all throughout the year. So for us, it's right around now. It's September, October, where I really start sitting down and planning the next year's actual budget. But I already have a lot of data to go on at that point. I know my electric bill is going to be this much more, and I know our cost of paper goods are going to be this much more. I say that I do that all myself, but I make sure that I have people to advise me. You know, our co-op and most co-ops have a board of directors. I submit everything to our board of directors. For us, that's 9 different eyes on what I do to ask questions. You know, is this sustainable? Is this viable? Are your numbers right? We also belong to a couple of cooperative organizations, for us, National Co-op Grocers, that looks at all of our financials and is that second set of eyes. And then lenders also, who have a very vested interest in the viability of your co-op, are also willing to take a look at your budgets and also your budget versus actuals to make sure that you're on track. So I know in a lot of co-ops, it does end up being one person generally who's responsible for this, but build a network of advisors.
No, that makes sense, John. And you mentioned lenders. So maybe, you know, Chris, from your perspective on the CFNE side, when a potential borrower or a current borrower comes to you with projections, what, you know, in a budget, what are you looking for? Are there key metrics? You know, do you have any thoughts on sort of do's and don'ts from the lender side?
Yeah, I think certainly, I mean, Bob, John emphasized it is like, do a budget and do it early. And that's really important. And then use it as a tool. And I think we'll see later, John does a regular sort of comparison of, and you can even break it down month to month, of how did we do versus budget, And the one guarantee is that the budget will never be exactly what you're going to earn in terms of revenue and profits, but how close were you? And generally you want to outperform your budget. And then you just want to figure out if things aren't going as well as planned, that kind of gives you a signal of, okay, let's figure out what's going on. Why are our revenues down compared to our budget? Or why do we have higher payroll expenses? It really helps you compare things. Because if you compare just your financial performance in a vacuum without comparing it to something else, you often just don't know how well you're doing. So it's a good tool, but you need to keep checking in on it throughout the year. And I'm guessing, John, if something big happens, you often adjust your budget as well to meet the reality. Because, you know, none of us can predict the future. And it's not that someone like us, a lender, would say, oh, you didn't meet your budget, gotcha, you're in trouble. We totally understand. No one can predict what's going on. And we'll have questions, but they're not questions to say, oh, you did a bad job at budgeting. It's just, hey, we know you're on top of it. Can you tell us a little more?
Yeah, I know. I mean, one thing from the legal side, working with clients, it's been particularly complicated over the last couple of years in preparing projections, right? And there's a question of, you know, well, what is sort of the baseline year, right? Is it going to be more like 2018 or 2019? Is, you know, the COVID 2020, 2021 business operations going to continue? Or are we somewhere in the middle, right? So there's all kinds of, you know, a challenging process has become even more challenging for a lot of businesses, right? And it really does, I think, take a collaborative approach, you know, whether it's talking to sort of department managers, anyone internally, right? Because people are going to have different perspectives on what they're seeing, what's selling, what's not, what the industry looks like, right? So it's definitely an art, more of a science. And I think it's probably become even more so just given some of the uncertainty we've seen, right? In terms of, why don't we go to the next slide? So in terms of other financial documents, my guess is that most co-ops have either these documents, the balance sheet, the profit and loss statement, and the cash flow statement, prepare them or have them prepared for you, or you have the financial information necessary to prepare them, right? But we thought it would be helpful to provide a little bit of background for those who, you know, aren't familiar with them. And we'll also take a look at a couple samples, right? So the first one here is the balance sheet, which is a detailed information about the company's assets, liabilities, and equity, right? And to balance it, you know, you'd have assets equaling liabilities plus equity. Then you have the profit and loss statement, which is going to report the revenue over a period of time, and then the costs and expenses associated with that revenue, right? And that's going to reflect your earnings or losses. Cash flow statement is going to report inflows and outflows of cash. And then not sort of one of the three, but one thing we obviously want to highlight, particularly based on the last discussion, is the need to compare the actuals versus the projections, right? So going back to see, you know, what did our actual cash flow look like compared to our projected cash flow, right? Are we above budget overall? Are we below budget? Are certain expenses higher than we had projected, and why is revenue down in this department? And you know, each business is going to have to set these up in a different way. It's going to have different categories, different metrics, and different levels of details, right? And so John was kind enough to provide us a couple of samples from Portland Food Co-op. If we scroll through to a couple more slides here, Rebecca, of the income statement. And this is, there's a lot more information that's hidden behind all of these numbers. John does a fantastic job and has tons of detail in his financial spreadsheets, which, you know, I love seeing from my perspective. So John, maybe you can just walk us through what we're looking at here. And, you know, as someone who's preparing this, when you look at it, you know, what does it tell you and how do you use it for the business operations?
Sure. I think I'll start just by giving folks just an idea of what's collapsed here. When I say collapsed, I mean what you're not seeing. This starts out as, I'm going to say, close to 100 lines in a spreadsheet For income, I break that down between all of our types of income. We are a food store, so we have departments. We have refrigerated, frozen meat, cheese, bread, bulk foods, et cetera. And so under income, I have the revenue for each of those departments. Under expenses is where you're really, that's where the bulk of this report is based on, and you're really not seeing any of it. Salaries and related expenses, I break it down by department, but also separate out workers' comp insurance, employer paid taxes, health insurance expense, staff discounts, supply RA contributions. And expenses, as you could think, it is right down to how many rolls of toilet paper we put in our public bathrooms. I really make sure that every expense has a category. And I use that every year to create the budget for the following year. And as Adam noted, the pandemic really put a kink in what used to be a fairly straightforward process. If I thought that, oh, I think revenue is gonna be up 6% next year, I could basically take an entire year's budget, add 6%, and have a pretty good template. But going through 2 years of, oh, that's right, last year we had customer counts, last year half the staff was out with COVID, all of these contingencies that affected our business, I was going back to 2019, which I call the last healthy year, and trying to project forward with that. But when I am constantly at the end of every month, I am pulling this and really making sure that we are, could you get right down to the bottom, net income, the number that matters. Are we at budget or are we above budget? And this is a very fortunate one year. I wish all of ours were this rosy. They're not. So don't feel intimidated if you think, oh, we're not doing this well. I chose one that looked good. Let's say I was not going to put a bad example up for public display. Obviously, this is also the most recent one too, but really knowing where am I at? And I think all of you, well, I don't want to assume everyone here really understands finances. Some of you are here to learn. The one line item, the one major expense that you have that does not show up in an income statement is principal paid on debt. The interest that you paid on debt is an expense, and that's in this budget, but you pay the principal on all of your debt out of net income. And so it's really important that your net income is, number one, includes how much loan repayment or principal on loan repayment you're making over the year, and then also that you're increasing the equity of the co-op and contributing to a rainy day fund and capital improvements and all of that stuff that you need to keep doing.
Yeah, great. Thanks, John. In terms of, maybe it makes sense to just compare and go ahead to the balance sheet that you provided a couple slides ahead. So the balance sheet is going to provide, you know, in my mind, sort of a more holistic view of the financials of the business, right? You know, really the valuation of the assets, the current cash in the checking account, other assets, any real estate, and then the short and long term liabilities, right? So it's not going to track your income in the same way, but it's going to provide a bigger picture of what are the major assets? What are the liabilities? And then whether or not there's any positive equity in the business. So, John, again, I think there's a lot collapsed down here in this balance sheet to make it fit on the screen. So you want to walk through sort of some of what we can't see and, again, how you use this?
Definitely. First of all, explain like how I view these two documents, the profit and loss and the balance sheet, are the two critical tools for financial management. I mean, the cash flow statement is very important. There are some other reports, but I always look, the balance sheet is that snapshot in time. Let's take today. What is the value and state of our business today? And this is what I use for things like, how much cash do we have on hand? What is our debt to equity ratio? And how are we doing on debt repayment? All of those things. Where do we stand today? The profit and loss is, how did we get here? The profit and loss is that comparison over time, which you always want to do, previous period, previous year, previous whatever comparisons, to chart, are you improving? And then that will be visible in the balance sheet. So, I'll walk through really quickly. Checks and savings, that's a cash on hand. You know, we have multiple accounts, but those are all collapsed down. Other current assets are basically money coming in that hasn't entered our checking account yet. For those of you who are retailers who accept credit card payments, you know that when the card gets swiped at the register, that money is not directly going into your account. It can take a day, 2-3 days. So we're always tracking how much money is in the credit card pipeline. There are some other things around that. It's basically sales that you have made, but you don't have the money yet. And then along with that is everything you own. Your equipment, if you own property, the inventory that you have on hand, all of the stuff that is in your name that makes up sort of the physical aspect of your cooperative, that's all bunched into that part called fixed assets. And so your cash and your fixed assets contribute to your total assets, which is everything that you own. And then it gets broken down to when liabilities and equity, I basically look at it as, this is how much stuff is in our name, how much do we own, and how much do we still owe on, which I think is a good way to look at the second half of a balance sheet. It's like, if you have a car payment or a mortgage, you always get that number of, here's how much you've paid off, here's how much you still owe, and that liabilities and equity piece is very equivalent to that. This is the breakdown of your co-op. How much do you still owe on it, basically? And you're always going to owe something, but the idea is to find a very healthy balance. So current liabilities and long-term liabilities, those are basically loan repayments. And we break those down between current liabilities is everything that's due within the next 12 months. And then long-term liabilities are everything else. Take out what's due in the next year and what's due in year 2, 3, 4, 5 and forward. And that's what I use to, it's one of the basis for budgeting is, what are our loan obligations next year? And I need to make sure that we're generating net income to at least achieve that. You know, that's sort of like a baseline. We have to achieve that in net income and then see what we need beyond that. And then, so there's total liabilities. Equity is how much of your business have you been able to actually own over time. And I can say when you start up a co-op, there could very well be a negative number there. There was a negative number there when we started. You know, we were in negative equity for probably like a year and a half where we actually owed more than we owned. But a healthy business, and that's a really important number to track over time, should always be moving in a positive direction. Every time you do a year over year, month over month, you want to be making headway in owning more of your cooperative until you decide to take on debt, buy new equipment, do an expansion, buy property, do something. That equity number is going to drop right back down again if you take on more debt. But the idea is to, in normal times, keep it moving in a healthy direction.
Yeah, thanks, John. So from, you know, I work with a lot of companies, like I said, who are going through, you know, financial challenges, right? And so there's a real interaction, I think, between the balance sheet and the income statement, right? And I think they tell you different things and you use them in different ways, right? And so, you know, I think at sort of the baseline, you need to see where the cash is on an operating basis to see if, you know, setting aside sort of debt service, is there a viable business purely operational, right? Like if the business, you know, before you're paying any debt service and the business is losing money just from operating, you know, revenue less operating expenses, then you may have a problem with whether or not there is a business that can survive long term here, right? So that's always sort of, you know, one thing to look at. And there's certainly, you know, changes that can be made to business operations, expenses, things like that to improve that. But it's a critical piece to understanding at least the sort of short term viability of the business, right? Whereas, you know, looking at the balance sheet and the restructuring, it you know, tells me sort of where are the big problems here, particularly if the business appears to be over leveraged in the sense that its liabilities far exceed its assets, so it has negative equity, right? And you know, sometimes there's solutions to that, right? There's, you know, you can sort of right size the liabilities through a bankruptcy process, through discussions with lenders. There's a lot of different, you know, through perhaps, you know, you need to raise new capital. There's a lot of different ways to deal with it, but they tell sort of each important but different stories. Chris, in terms of, you know, your work, I imagine you're seeing, you know, all of these documents on a monthly, quarterly, annually basis. What are some of the critical things you look for, and how do you use them when you receive them?
Yeah, we generally ask clients send in quarterly reports, and we understand they're internal. So it's okay if you're not completely, you know, there'll be some adjustments later on. And then at the end of the year, we do ask for the end of the year tax return that you file with the IRS in your local state. But the things that we really focus on, and probably you will too, is there are some items on the balance sheet that you don't need to check on weekly or monthly, maybe at most quarterly, and sometimes only once a year. And the items that John mentioned, I really just focus on the things on a month-to-month basis, things that have current in front of them, current assets and current liabilities. And obviously you're going to focus on your checking account. That's probably a daily, if not, you know, at least weekly piece that you're checking on. Important thing is to always, you know, work on that reconciliation of what's on your bank statement and what's in your QuickBooks accounting, and make sure that is really up to date, because the numbers may not be correct. You may think you have more cash than you really do. And the other piece I would say is be careful with your accounts receivable. Generally you would say more assets is good, but if your accounts receivable start to blow up, that means you're actually not being paid on time. So I'd say just be careful and not always think more cash is generally good, but more accounts receivable that people owe you money is not always a good thing, because that means people aren't paying you back on time. Yeah,
it's good. It's good to, you know, generate the accounts receivable, but if you're not converting them to cash, right? You cannot. You can't pay employees. You can't pay other vendors from accounts receivable, right? You need to convert it to cash. And you know, I think most businesses, you know, should or do have, you know, an accounts receivable aging report where you can track those, or you know, 30, 60, 90 day or longer receivables, and make sure.
Just one more point. Just simple calculation for those who, you know, are new to this. Just a quick thing that I would do is just look at your total current assets and your total current liabilities, and just make sure the first one is bigger than the second one. You generally just want current assets to be a lot bigger than current liabilities. So that's just an easy math. You can see here with Portland, you know, they got more than 2x more in current assets than current liabilities. Yeah, sorry. Thanks, Ed.
No, that's great. Thanks, Chris. And too, on something you said, Chris, talking about the bank accounts, in terms of, you know, the cash in the bank account versus the cash in QuickBooks. So I don't know if you want to address that, Chris, or, you know, maybe John can from his perspective, but it's a really important distinction because they're not the same number, but they're, you know, it's very important to understand why they're not the same number and to make sure they're accurate.
I'll give a quick, just my own experience with it, and then Chris, you can spell off that. I know for us being a grocery store, we have cash in movement all of the time. It's like retail food is a very much a nickel and dime business. It is bring product in, move it out, bring it in, move it out. So we are buying tens of thousands of dollars worth of food every week from 50 different vendors. So that's all invoices coming in and checks going out. And then we have money coming in through the cash registers. And then you have payroll, which is a huge drop when that happens. And so there are lots of small and some very big numbers that are constantly cycling. And so that number in your checking account, I mean, can fluctuate drastically. And so that's that important thing about days of cash on hand. Never assume just because you see a comfortable amount in there, there might be a $10,000 check floating out there that you forgot about. So don't go spending it just because you see it in the checking account. And I think that's personal life advice as well as business advice. Make sure that all of your expenses are spoken for, because the bank account is never a good example or indicator of how much cash you actually have.
Yeah, I'm always surprised still how many businesses, you know, operate on checks or only accept checks, right? And instead of, you know, wire or sort of ACH payments, which, you know, or more simultaneously will reflect in your bank accounts. But particularly if you're a business that's paying a lot of creditors by check, right? There's obviously a timing function. You know, it takes a few days, sometimes longer, for the check to arrive in the mail. And then it takes a few more days for it to cash, right? And so that, you know, when you write the check in your QuickBooks or, you know, Excel ledger, right, you want to reflect that check being written in the debit from your account, but it's not going to show up in your bank account for, you know, maybe 7, 10, 14 days, right? So if you don't have that tracking, particularly if you operate on, you know, low cash generally, right, you could find yourself, you know, having overdraft problems on the bank account, checks bouncing. And that is, you know, usually not a good sign. It's going to create a lot of problems with vendors as well, right? All right, why don't we go ahead to the next slide, see if we can stay on track here time-wise. So we talked about, you know, the budgeting process. We talked about some of the common financial documents. Next thing we wanted to sort of pause on is how to actually use those documents, right? The information is only valuable to the extent that, you know how to use it, right? And I think the first thing sort of highlighting here is just the timeliness of the information. You know, different time periods are going to have different value depending on what you want to do. But it's really important to turn around the financial information on a timely basis, right? So, you know, if you're a grocery store and, you know, you have to input certain, you know, maybe sales data, and you don't finalize your, you know, March sales data until June, right? It's not going to be very helpful to tell you what to do in, you know, April and May, right? You're just going to be missing out on the information, and it's going to be old and stale by the time you get it. So establishing that process to turn it around quickly and then turning around the data. And a lot of it can be automated. John, I'd be curious to hear, you know, how much data is done manually versus automated for your business. I know there's a wide variety, but then there's, you know, there's daily sales reports, there's weekly financials, there's monthly, quarterly financials you may share with the lender. And then obviously you have, you know, your annual sort of year-end reports and even audited annual financials sometimes, right? So John, maybe turn it back over to you in terms of the data input process and the timing. How does that operate for your business?
I look at the basics of like sales reports every day, and those are a function. We have a point of sale system and an accounting system. Unfortunately, they are not integrated, but between the two of them, it's very easy for me to just get that quick snapshot. You know, what was today compared to yesterday, compared to the day before, compared to a week ago, so that I always feel like I have at least my finger on the pulse of where we're at right now. I create, through information generated from these reports, a weekly sales report that I share with my entire leadership team. It's called the WSR Weekly Sales Report, and it's a snapshot for everybody to see sales by department and payroll by department. So everyone just has, and it just gives, and there's some calculations that happen in there because payroll is our largest single expense beyond cost of goods. And that's our business model. That's not the same if you're a professional service or a farm or doing anything else. You will have other priorities in terms of what your major expenses are, but for a retail environment is payroll. And so it's always looking, was our payroll for the week appropriate for the amount of sales we did? Because in a retail environment, that ratio will you sink or swim on whether you are generating enough sales for the payroll expense that you have. And so you do that. And then that leads to monthly. I do what we just seen here. I do profit and loss balance sheet and cash flow statements. They are just estimates for us on a monthly basis, because when you're a retail store, you don't have accurate financial statements unless you accurately know the value of your inventory on hand. So for us, you know, we're constantly buying and selling things, but every 3 months, we actually physically count everything that we have on our shelves so that we know as a baseline, this is how much we owned in goods at the beginning of the period. This is how much we still owned at the end of it. This is what we bought and sold. Therefore, this is what our net income is. So for us, the quarterly income statements are the most accurate ones, but I would never wait until the end of the quarter to actually know how my business was doing. Getting it down to a day and a week and sharing that with the other people in your co-op, even if they are not finance people, bringing in them into the fold of why this matters is really, really important.
Yeah, John, I think that the audience is a key part of that too, right? So different audiences are going to want information presented differently and want different information, right? So, you know, a department manager may want or may be valuable to see, you know, really granular data, right? Whereas if you're doing a financial presentation to the board, you may want to have a little more aggregated data, right? Not that the data is not available, but you may present it in a little different way at risk of getting lost in the numbers, right? If you're, you know, the board may be less interested in, you know, the toilet paper spend on a weekly basis, but they may be very interested in, you know, overall operating expenses, right? And not operating expenses. So what are some of the audiences that use the data, and then how do you adjust it within the co-op?
Well, yes, I would say that's a very, very good point, because the most granular, like sales by department, expenses by department, that's mostly internal. That's to share with the other folks in our co-op. And I share a lot of that broadly, because even for folks who that kind of management doesn't sort of fall within their purview or job description, I really think it's important for everyone to understand the whys. You know, why are we doing this? Why do we have to do it this way? You know, why are we, you know, purchasing this, or why aren't we doing that? And bringing people into the idea that we have a budget that we have to follow, and it's really important. But you're right, sort of the farther away from operations we get, the more condensed these reports get. Like I said, even for my own board, I don't give them department breakdown. They're not involved in operations. They're involved in the viability of the co-op. So they hire me to manage the operations. They get income and expenses, and they get expenses fairly broken down, not to the level of paper towels and toilet paper, but highline, what are we spending on office supplies, just as a double check that I'm managing things appropriately. And then I think that seems to go actually, Chris sees our financial statements, because Cooperative Fund of the Northeast is a lender to the Portland Food Co-op. So, but I'm sure with them, they are not interested as much in the granular stuff. But are we running a sustainable business? Are the important high-level categories producing the numbers we need so that the basic metrics, gross margin, net income, debt to equity, things like that, that they're all looking healthy and in line?
Yeah. So Chris, from your side of the information, is there anything that you see that is more useful for, you know, CFE or, you know, presentation wise? And then, you know, maybe it's worth touching on the importance of the timely information. I would imagine, and, you know, correct me, but, you know, when quarterly financials are due and they're not done on time, or an audit's not done on time, I imagine that catches your attention and raises some questions, right?
Yeah, I'll cover that first. So we're definitely flexible on that. Especially, I guess when we get worried is when the communication stops and we don't have the financials. So as long as you're communicating with us and say, hey, we're a little late, we had a big month, we had a big event, our accountant is sick, that kind of thing, totally fine. But you know, without communication is the hard part. The point here on this slide that I would probably stress both for our use and for, I think, managers use and employees and board of directors is really that fourth bullet. Is I once looked at the accounting profession and I just figured out it wasn't for me, but finance was. And it's really that analysis piece of the why and what's happening is more interesting to me. And I think it's more interesting to those audiences that John spoke about. So, you know, comparing what just happened last month in the last quarter versus this time last year, 2021, comparing it to budget and comparing it to my peers just makes it more understandable and digestible. than just throwing a bunch of numbers. Oh, we made $1 million this year. Okay. If you made $2 million last year, that's not so good. So you always got to compare things and put it really in context. And we have a lot of food costs within our portfolio, and we have, you know, quite a few coffee shops. So housing cooperatives. So we roughly know, you know, how those different cooperatives are doing based on certain metrics. And we do those comparisons too. And we're happy to share that in a global way to see how you compare to other housing co-ops or other food co-ops, that sort of thing.
Yeah, and Chris, the communication point, I think, is one that's going to come up when we get to some of the signs of financial distress towards the end. But really, really critical point, particularly with, you know, important players in your business, like your lenders, right? It's really important to communicate, and, you know, more times than not, prompt and honest communications are going to get you in a far better place than a lack of communication or hoping sort of problems can get swept under the rug. So that's just it's a really good point in how you approach this stuff.
Yeah. And the only other thing I would add, as I mentioned it earlier, is just we know, like John said, we know monthly and quarterly reports aren't going to be perfect and that there's probably going to be some adjustments along the way. So next quarters might look different, or, you know, a lot of times adjustments are made at the end of the year. I wouldn't worry about if, you know, like there's a big, like, ugly adjustment coming, you know, tell us ahead of time just so we don't get surprised. But, you know, I'd say we understand in between the 12 months, it's your best estimate, and that things happen and change at the end of the year. So don't get too concerned about that.
Yeah. I think, John, you had mentioned, in terms of sort of analysis, and we talked about, you know, comparisons of actual budgets, but I think you mentioned looking at some industry data as well and sort of peer grocery stores. What type of information do you use for that, and how is it helpful?
It is, we reach out, and I alluded to this or mentioned it earlier, that our co-op belongs to a national organization called National Co-op Grocers, and they do share trends with all of the member co-ops so that we know how we're performing compared to, say, 20 or 30 other co-ops our size. This is specifically for food co-ops, but I mean, there are a lot of different co-op sectors that have their peer groups or affinity groups and access to things like this. So you can say, oh, a co-op our size in this state, you know, this is how much what their gross margin is, or oh, this is how much they're spending on staffing, or it gives you a sense of whether you're sort of in line or not. For dogs, I think it came up a little earlier, I think in a chat, someone asking about other resources. If you don't have anything like this in your area, I find actually the advisors at SCORE to be some of the best and free access you have to financial help. In the very beginning when we were unaffiliated, I worked with actually a SCORE advisor who did a lot, who offered some really great advice on the fundamentals.
Yeah, and just to add to that, both I think SCORE volunteers and small business development, SBDC of employees, they have access to databases for just about every industry. I just saw performance ratios for garden centers. Thank you, Frank. And they have access to all those free databases that you can kind of benchmark yourself if you don't belong to an association. I know sometimes your libraries do. The reference librarians are your friends. And then sometimes, I know I live in Bangor, sometimes the cities themselves, the economic development departments, have databases that you don't have to pay for, basically get for free. But yeah, start with your SCORE and your SBDC to get some of those metrics in your industry.
And John, I received a question about how often you review your expenses and whether you review them less frequently than maybe you did when the business was new. My guess is you're reviewing it on a daily or weekly basis, but what are
more now than I ever used to. The bigger you get, the and the more you start needing to share purchasing power or purchasing ability, sort of open up the checkbook to more members of the cooperative. If you're the one who's end of the day responsible for the financial management, you need to have proper oversight, because people sometimes just don't know. I've had staff thinking that, oh, spending whatever, $3,000 on this, oh, the co-op can afford that, it's appropriate. I see it come through and I'm like, oh, heck no. And so no, it is more important the bigger you get to really have eyes on really every transaction. I mean, I go through our accounting software line by line by line pretty regularly, just to get a sense of, I at least do it by categories because I know what the number should be. And that's where that budget thing really helps. That as soon as I see any line item getting out of budget, I'm like, okay, I got to investigate this just to make sure that somebody's spending money and not realizing that they've already reached their budget and they need to stop. So yeah, don't ever be that stereotypical, I don't want to say guy because there's always a guy who just throws a bunch of paper receipts in a shoebox and brings them to the accountant at the end of the month, because you have no idea what's in there. We have a policy at our co-op of 24-hour turnaround, that anytime you get a receipt, an invoice, it is dated, received, coded, initialed, and turned into accounting within 24 hours of receipt. And then our accountant is our account manager is very diligent about entering those into our software, so that when I open it up and are looking at our expenses, I can be very comfortable that every significant expense is in there and fairly up to date, except what's happening as I'm speaking.
Yeah, that absolutely, John. And I think, so when you had presented, I think with Chris, maybe early this year, late last year, you had brought some really great examples of just how you demonstrate some of the performance and trends of the business. So we've included a few more of those here. We have a few minutes left here. So you want to just walk us through some of the slides and, you know, what the information is and how you use it?
Sure. All right. This is a chart, obviously quarterly. And this is that it is so important to not just have snapshots of how your business is doing at any given point of time, looking at your trends over time. And as you can see here, these look funny because we're talking 2020, 21, 22. And if anyone wanted to take a deep dive, you could sort of see when the pandemic hit and how it affected our business and how we recovered from it. But it's looking at sales over time. This is so important to know that you're trending in the right direction, but also you could have a very seasonable business. And so you need to know what those seasons are, so that you, before you enter a downturn in your season, which for many of us here in Maine, unless you're in ski slope areas or snowmobile areas, is probably the dead of winter, that you're preparing for negative cash flow in those months, and that you've built up adequate savings to see you through to the springtime. So yeah, trends over time, being able to know where you're going over time, so important, and the longer the better. Right. Net income, another really important one. Easy to see when the pandemic hit us. I was saying, same thing. How everybody's, congratulations if you find yourself in a business where your net income is stable month to month over the course of the year. There are very few businesses that are like that. I think of farms being the most drastic example of cash flow being very different from the dead of winter to early fall. And so tracking your net income quarter by quarter over the year, same thing as tracking sales. You know when your profitable times are. And your profitable times might not always be your busiest times. And that's why it's important to treat these two things separately. Especially if you're some kind of producer where you produce things in advance and then you sell them at a later point in time. So really understanding what months you should rely on cash coming in. And that way you are able to set off some alarms if we're in the cash coming in time and it's not here yet. And I think this same thing, payroll as a percent of sales. Being a retail business, like payroll is our number one operational expense outside of the cost of goods. You know, buying the product that we sell is 65% of everything we spend. Payroll is number two, generally running around 23%. The pandemic made this very wonky for a while. You know, we were obviously paying for staff when we didn't have the sales because we were trying to get everyone through the pandemic. For us, this does not normally look like this. These are very much pandemic influence graphs, but whatever your major expense is, tracking that independently over time, really, really important to make sure that it's either stable or it's fluctuating along with your sales and income. And here, days of cash on hand. That same one, track that over time. Everybody fluctuates. We definitely, especially sort of in the deepest days of the pandemic, got down lower than I was ever comfortable with. But fortunately for our business, retail food stores were not affected in the same way as hospitality restaurants and a lot of other businesses out there, that it was not as much of a dip for us as it was for everyone else. But always knowing where your cash trend is, and it should never be dropping unless you had planned and budgeted for it. Like I said, if you are a seasonal business and you're in the depths of your slow season, okay, days of cash on hand might have dropped then, but you should be aware of that. Days of cash on hand should never catch you off guard. It should never be a surprise.
Yeah, thanks. I really like the last one, particularly in my work. Cash is critical in monitoring it. And so I think having this and tracking it, and, you know, there's a lot of obviously seasonality for, you know, we're all in Maine, but you know, throughout the country, there's a lot of seasonality of businesses. So it's okay to dip as long as, like you said, John, you're planning and are aware of it, which I think maybe my number one goal is to keep us on time. So why don't we go to, we have one more slide here, which is just common signs of financial distress. And there's a short article I've written about it, which perhaps we can share with the group afterwards with more information. But, you know, all of what we've provided in terms of, or talked about in terms of the financial reports and comparing to budget and timeliness of data, it's all intended to help you maintain and understand that you have a strong financial business, right? And that your constituents have the ability to see that as well, right? And so one thing, you know, in my world, working with a lot of companies in financial distress, is there are a lot of common financial challenges that we see, right? So obviously, you know, trends of decreasing revenue, you know, if you start having to slow pay vendors, you know, you get out of terms, often just suggests a problem with cash, frequent cash shortages, right? You're running out of cash to pay certain things, you're deferring payments. Those are all sort of short-term problems. And then, you know, one other see frequently, which is not always a problem, but perhaps a sign to look more closely, is just deferred maintenance and capital improvements, right? And that can mean a lot of different things to different businesses, but you know, if you're a grocery store that, you know, hasn't updated its refrigeration units in, you know, 20 or 30 years, and they have a lifespan of 10 years, you may have some big expenses coming, right? And if you haven't had the ability to maintain the basics of your business to continue operating, that could have, you know, negative effects on expenses and future revenue, you know, customer. You know, reaction and how you appear to them, right? So there's a lot of implications of that as well. It's something to think about. So, and I think Chris shared the link to that article I mentioned. So let me stop there. I think we've addressed all of the questions we've received. If we have not, my apologies. We tried to fit it all in. On the last slide, you'll see we have our contact information for Chris, John, and myself. I think we're all more than happy to receive any questions or comments afterwards, so don't hesitate to reach out. And I appreciate everyone joining us today, and I hope you're able to join us for the last two webinars that we have coming up. So thank you.
Thank you all.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks. Thank you, Claudio.